Here we are at the beginning of a fascinating journey through a country with thousands of years of culture, history, and art. Italy. What we want to do is to illustrate the artistic and monumental aspect of its most famous cities. All roads lead to Rome. The Via Appia, the most important and most ancient of the great consular roads to Rome. At the time of the empire's greatest splendor, it had a population of more than 1 million inhabitants. It was a cosmopolitan city, with many forums, basilicas, markets and public baths, theaters, amphitheaters and circuses, not to mention splendid gardens and magnificent palaces. Innumerable temples were dedicated not only to the gods of Olympus, but also to pagan deities from every province of the empire. Strong bridges linked the two banks of the Tiber. Arches of triumph, commemorative columns, and thousands of statues in marble and gilded bronze gave the eternal city a monumental appearance that was unique. When the ancient world crumbled, Rome took its place at the head of the Christian church and later emerged as a center of culture during the Middle Ages, the Renaissance and the Baroque period. Let us admire an incomparable view over the roofs and hundreds of domes of the city. According to tradition, in the 8th century before Christ, Romulus founded the city on the Palatine Hill. Here you can see the traces left by the huts of that original settlement. On the same hill, Augustus was to begin in the first century before Christ, the building of an imperial residence that was later to be enlarged and embellished by the Flavian clan. Here we see the Nymphaeum, once covered in precious marble and decorated with mosaics and statues. Nearby, a hippodrome or racetrack in the form of a circus, consisting of a portico with two floors that probably served as a garden and exercise ground as well. The Roman Forum became established as the political, religious, legal, administrative, and commercial center of the ancient city-state after the draining by means of the Cloaca Maxima, the great sewer, built in early Republican times of the low-lying land between the Palatine, Capitoline, and Quirinal hills. Let us see the most important monuments in the model reconstruction. The Roman Forum, seen from the Campidoglio, in all its glory. The same seen from the Arch of Titus. The background is formed by the slopes of the Campidoglio. The Temple of Antoninus and Faustina, built by the Senate in the 2nd century BC. The Temple of Divus Julius, built by Augustus in 29 BC, on the spot where Julius Caesar's body was cremated. The Temple of Vesta, where the Vestal Virgins kept the sacred fire, the symbol of the life of the urbs, the city. The Temple of Castor and Pollux was dedicated to the heavenly twins to celebrate the beginning of the Republic. The remains of the Clivius Capitolinus, the road leading up to the Capitol. On the slopes of the hill, are the huge structures of the tabularium, or state archives, 1st century BC. The Arch of Septimius Severus. It was dedicated to this emperor in 203 after Christ. Beside it is the enormous facade of the Curia, the seat of the Roman Senate. The largest basilica of the Forum was built by Maxentius and Constantine at the beginning of the 4th century after Christ. This is the huge vaulted roof with its ceiling of octagonal lucernas. Basilicas were used for the administration of justice and business in general. This sequence of maps shows Rome's territorial expansion through the centuries. Rome at the time of its foundation, 8th century before Christ. Rome's dominions after the Punic Wars. Rome's conquests at the time of Augustus Caesar. The greatest expansion of the empire under Trajan, 2nd century AD. The Roman Forum, having become insufficient for the needs of the city, was supplemented with the construction of the Imperial Forums, thus putting into effect the great town planning scheme started by Julius Caesar, carried on by Augustus, and finally concluded by Trajan. Now let us visit the forums in chronological order. Julius Caesar's forum, begun in 54 BC, consisted of a large square surrounded by taberni, that is to say, market booths or shops in a portico. In the center was the temple of Venus Genetrix. The forum of Augustus, with the temple of Mars Ultor, built to commemorate the victory at Philippi in 42 BC over the conspirators Brutus and Cassius, the assassins of Julius Caesar. Trajan's Forum, a complex of buildings consisting of a large market on three floors, crossed by the Via Biberatica, also lined with shops. This is one of the best preserved remains in Rome. Next door to the Forum is the Basilica Ulpia, with its five naves and the column erected by Trajan to commemorate his victory over the Dacians. The most dramatic moments of the defeat of the barbarians who, although overwhelmed by the military might of Rome, preserved their pride and dignity, is told in a continuous frieze with 2,500 figures. The Colosseum, the great amphitheater built by Vespasian, was inaugurated by the Emperor Titus in the year 80 AD. Built in only 8 years, it could hold 50,000 spectators. The cavea, the seating for the spectators, was reached by 76 entrances consecutively numbered. This is entrance number 45. Part of the outer ring of walls is missing as a result of earthquakes and the use of the building as a quarry for building stone. These holes were made in the Middle Ages so as to recover the bronze clamps that held the blocks of travertine marble together. The cavea consisted of a ramp of seats that, from the oval of the arena, rose up to the balconies and was divided into sectors according to the various social classes. In summer, an immense sheet of cloth, an awning, protected the spectators from the heat of the sun. Below the surface of the arena were the services needed for the performances. These consisted in wild beast hunts and gladiatorial combats. The arena was floored with wood, which has now disappeared, of course. Here you can see how the beasts were raised to the arena. Prodded out of their cages, the animals went along a narrow passageway and into small elevators worked on a counterpoise. Then, moving up a short ramp, they found themselves in the open arena facing the bestiari. An iron grating that ran all the way round the arena was fitted at its base with ivory rollers that turned horizontally, thus preventing the beasts from climbing over it. Behind the grating, in any case, there were archers always ready to intervene. Archaeological documentation on gladiatorial combats and costumes. The Hoplomachus. Gladiatorial combat. A rare picture of a fight between women gladiators. A venazione, or wild beast hunt. In these two mosaics, the famous fighters are indicated by their proper names. In this reconstruction, we see the gigantic Hoplomachus, heavily armed, facing a lightly armed Thracian. In another, the Retiarius, with his bell-shaped net, tries to entangle the Mirmillo, or fishman, and stick him with his trident. A fallen gladiator asked for the emperor's mercy, and he, having consulted the crowd, gave his decision. Thumb down meant death. The victor carried out the sentence. In the 18th century, Pope Benedict XIV consecrated the amphitheater to the Passion of Christ, thus putting an end to the devastation and quarry. Opposite the Colosseum, we find the Temple of Venus and Rome, built by Hadrian in the 2nd century after Christ. It was the largest temple in ancient Rome and was decorated with a portico of 150 columns. The Arch of Constantine was erected in 315 AD to celebrate Constantine's victory over Maxentius. The decorative elements, however, come from much older monuments. The few reliefs carried out expressly for this arch consist of a series of figures seen frontally according to the order of importance. Without naturalistic spacing, they mark the beginning of a break with the classical world and the approach of medieval art. The Arch of Titus was built to commemorate the conquest of Jerusalem in 70 AD. In the inscription on the upper part we read, Senatus Populusque Romanus, that is to say, the Senate and People of Rome. The initials SPQR were the seal of authority exercised by the state as a direct emanation of the power of the Senate and the will of the people. On the relief under the arch, we see the triumph of Titus. Among the details, we see the loot from the temple at Jerusalem, the silver trumpets, the golden table of the showbread, and the seven-branch candlestick. This is the oldest representation of a menorah that has been handed down to us. At the foot of the huge complex of buildings that made up the imperial palaces, we find the Circus Maximus. This is the largest building dedicated to entertainment in the ancient world. It was 660 yards long and could hold 250,000 spectators. Here we see it as it was at the time of the Emperor Constantine, It was in this circus that the chariot races took place. In this ancient relief, we see a four-horse chariot as it finishes a race of seven laps over the course. And in these mosaics are the charioteers, wearing the colors of the factions of the circus. Not far from the Circus Maximus, in the area of the Forum Boarium, the Roman cattle market, we find two temples of the Republican period, dedicated one to Hercules Olivarius, the patron of oil merchants, and the other to Portunus, a deity protecting ports. Close by is the Arch of Janus, a covered passage with four doors. It served as a meeting place and a shelter. Also close to the Forum Boarium is the island in the Tiber, served by two Roman bridges, Chestius on the left and Fabricius on the right. Near the last named bridge is the synagogue, built in 1904 on the foundations of a 16th century building. The Pantheon, a masterpiece of Roman engineering, was built by Hadrian in 125 AD as a temple dedicated to all the gods. The dome was the largest in the world in concrete until the present century. It has a diameter of 142 feet, equal to the height of the building. The great central oculus, the only source of light for the whole building, is over 29 feet in diameter. In the Pantheon, consecrated as a Christian church in the 8th century, are the tombs of the kings of United Italy and that of the great painter Raphael, who died at the age of only 37 in April 1520. The immense drum which supports the dome has walls over 19 feet thick. The portico has 16 columns, each of one piece of Egyptian granite. On the left bank of the Tiber, the Emperor Hadrian had his grandiose mausoleum built. It was so large that it was later transformed into a papal fortress, being given the name of Castel Sant'Angelo. The Ponte Sant'Angelo, the Sant'Angelo Bridge, decorated in the 17th century with statues by Bernini, is the ancient Ponte Elio, built as an access way to the mausoleum. In the 4th century before Christ, the ancient city of Rome had a belt of walls in massive blocks of tufa that was nearly 4.5 miles long. Here are some remains. The last belt of walls built around Rome was that of the Emperor Aurelian, built in the 3rd century after Christ, that was 11.25 miles long. These new walls, a third of which are still standing, were built of bricks and mortar and had 14 main gates and 383 towers. During their construction, advantage was taken of existing structures, such as, for example, the pyramid that is the tomb of Caius Chestius, included in the walls near the Ostia Gate. The Appian Way, the most ancient of the great consular roads of Rome, was built in 312 before Christ by the censor Appius Claudius. Over 400 miles long, it linked Rome with southern Italy, in particular Brindisi, the ancient military port where the legions embarked for Greece, Asia Minor, and Egypt. The tomb of Cecilia Metella on the ancient Appian Way is very well preserved. It was built for the daughter-in-law of Marcus Licinius Crassus, triumvir, and one of Caesar's generals in Gaul. In the 13th century, it became a fortress for the Caetani family. Close to the Appian Way in the Roman Campania are the picturesque ruins of an ancient aqueduct. Also close to the Appian Way, we find some of the most important of the 63 catacombs already explored. They are underground cemeteries whose tunnels wind and branch for miles and at different levels in the tufa rock. They were dug between the 2nd and the 5th centuries after Christ by Christian communities, abandoned for centuries and then rediscovered one after the other between the 16th and the 19th centuries. St. Paul Without the Walls, another of Constantine's basilicas, built over the tomb of the apostle. Rebuilt after the fire of 1823, it is resplendent with mosaics having a golden background. In the interior, with five naves, there are still ancient mosaics of the 13th century. The cloister of the adjoining Benedictine monastery is also of the 13th century. With Piazza del Campidoglio, we move into the Renaissance phase of the city of Rome. The square, a work of genius by Michelangelo, is on the Capitoline Hill and is bounded on one side by Palazzo Senatorio, the seat of the city government, and on the other two by the Palazzo Capitolino and the Palazzo dei Conservatori. The last two act as wings, and their oblique setting makes the square seem even larger than it actually is. The convexity of the paving symbolizes the summit of a hill, while the star design suggests the facets of a diamond. The bronze statue of Marcus Aurelius, taken from the Lateran, is a superb and unique example of a Roman equestrian monument and has served as a model for sculptors for centuries. In the ancient Basilica of St. Peter in Chains, founded by the Empress Eudoxia in the 5th century to house the chains of St. Peter, is Michelangelo's celebrated Moses, carved in 1514 for the mausoleum of Pope Julius II. The lawgiver and guide of the people of Israel, having descended from Mount Sinai, holds the table of the laws firmly. The powerful figure is an echo of the prophets in the Sistine Chapel. The muscular strength of the left arm is incredible, while the face still reflects the shock of divine revelation in an intense light symbolized by the two horns. Now, with the Fontana del Tritone by Bernini, 1643, we begin a review of Baroque fountains. Four dolphins hold up the badge of the Barberini family with their tails, as well as a giant scallop shell from which rises the powerful figure of the merman who, blowing through a conch, sends a jet of water high into the air. Also to Bernini, we owe the tiny Fontana delle Api. Bees are the symbol of the Barberini family. But Bernini's genius found its highest expression in the Fontana dei Quattro Fiumi, the fountain of the four rivers in the middle of Piazza Navona. On a perforated rock stands a daringly balanced obelisk. The dove, symbol of the Pamphili family, is above the statues that represent the greatest rivers of the four continents. The Nile is the river of Africa. The Ganges, that of Asia. The Rio de la Plata, America. And the Danube, Europe. The rock is enlivened by fish and fantastic animals. Foliage and fruit. A palm tree bending before the wind. An exhausted lion crawling down to drink. A rearing thoroughbred. And limpid veils of splashing water. The work of the master's fertile imagination that achieves a happy result full of unity and harmony. Minor artists executed the Fountain of the Moor, and the Fountain of Neptune. The facade of the Church of St. Agnes is by Borromini. The piazza is built on the ruins of Domitian's stadium for athletic displays and has kept the exact shape of the track. The fantastic complex, so beautifully arranged by Bernini, was ordered by Pope Innocent X Pamphili as the center of the new Baroque city. The Barcaccia Fountain is the work of Gian Lorenzo Bernini's father. The fountain was inspired by a boat washed up by an exceptional flood of the Tiber. The fountain is situated at the foot of the Spanish steps up to the Trinità dei Monti, predominant element in Piazza di Spagna, so called because of the nearby Spanish embassy. The monumental and theatrical stairway was conceived by Alessandro Specchi in 1725 as a means of access to the church above. There are 138 steps and 3 flights and 3 landings, a reference to the Trinity above. Its stunning effect is greatly increased in late spring when the stairway is covered with flowering azaleas. The review of the Baroque fountains ends with Fontana di Trevi, the most famous fountain in all the world. It was built in 1735 on a design by Nicola Salvi. The sea god Neptune is driving a chariot shaped like a scallop shell, drawn by 2 fiery seahorses. The Trevi Fountain is fascinating for the roar of its waters that seem to spring naturally from the rock in a splendor of marble and honey-colored travertine. According to tradition, the tourist who throws a coin in the fountain will return to Rome. Piazza Venezia takes its name from the 15th century palace that was the residence of the Venetian Cardinal Pietro Barbo. The monument to King Victor Emmanuel II is the work of Giuseppe Sacconi and was inaugurated in 1911 to celebrate the unification of Italy in 1861. The immense mass of white Botticino marble does not blend with its surroundings. From the entrance to the Villa of the Knights of Malta on the Aventine Hill, one has an unusual view of the Dome of St. Peter's. The Vatican City, a city within a city, a state within a state, stands on and around the place where, in 67 AD, Peter was martyred. In 1929, the Lateran Treaty granted independence to the Vatican, thus creating a state with an area of 108.7 acres and a population of approximately 400 and its own flag. It mints its own money, which circulates freely in Italy, and issues postage stamps. Has its own radio and television transmitting station and its own railroad station. St. Peter's Square and Basilica. Since the Basilica built by Constantine was crumbling away in 1546, Michelangelo, followed by various other architects, redeveloped Bramante's plan of a church in the shape of a Greek cross. With masterly skill and daring, he raised the towering dome and followed the work on the project, later carried on by Giacomo della Porta and Maderno, who lengthened the nave of the basilica. A salute from the Swiss guards in their picturesque 16th century uniforms. In the 17th century, Bernini added the colonnade with 140 statues of saints and popes to crown the exceptional work. Seen from the center of the square, the colonnade seems to consist of a single file of columns. But when you move off center, as can be seen in this shot, you can see that it consists of four files that look like a whole forest of stone. Here at noon on Sundays, the Holy Father appears at the window of his apartments to bless the faithful.
Et benedictio Dei omnipotentis, Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti, descenda super vos et maneat semper.
Through the grandiose atrium, we enter the basilica. In the interior, the immense, breathtaking central nave rises up to the roof high above us. The first six arches correspond to the extension added by Maderno, while the last two are part of Michelangelo's plan. Later, Bernini succeeded in aesthetically joining the two structures by means of the light and color which reign in this extraordinary building. There is a wealth of decoration in the interior. 440 statues, 500 columns, 44 altars, and 11 domes. It is a complex of gigantic masses, a splendor of stucco, gold, bronze, colored marbles and mosaics, a chiaroscuro of rays of light and pools of shade. Immediately below the immense dome is Bernini's immense baldacchino. Gian Lorenzo Bernini was only 26 when he substituted the traditional brickwork ciboria with a baldacchino in bronze in imitation of those in cloth, that, in spite of its enormous size, it is nearly 86 feet high, stands lightly over the papal altar. In the background, the dove in the apse lights the throne of St. Peter, supported by four doctors of the church, another work by Bernini. Close to one of the pilasters supporting the dome, in front of a beautiful mosaic in gold leaf, is the bronze statue of St. Peter, venerated by the faithful, who in the course of 700 years have worn down the foot with their kisses and caresses. Along the central nave are marked the lengths of the naves of the largest churches in the world. St. Peter's is the largest, 614 feet. Then comes St. Paul's in London. Then the Cathedral in Florence. Notre Dame of Paris. And St. Patrick's in New York, 334 feet. The holy water stoops, which one hardly notices from a distance, are actually over 6 feet tall. The decoration in the interior of the basilica consists of an innumerable series of mosaics that are unique in this world and carried out by the eminent artists of the Reverenda Fabrica di San Pietro in the past. The Pietà, carved by Michelangelo at the age of 26, is the first of four on the same subject. It shows the resigned suffering of the mother who lovingly holds the body of a beautiful Christ on her lap, and is the only work signed by Michelangelo. In the holy 15th century work of refined technical execution and rich in masses of deep chiaroscuro, what strikes us most is the contrast between the gigantic figure of the Virgin and the thin body of the Son that weighs on the mother's knees, utterly limp and lifeless. In these extremely dramatic shots, we show the damage done by a madman with a hammer on May 21st, 1972, before restoration. La Porta Santa, the Holy Door, is opened and closed after 12 months every quarter of a century for the Jubilee or Holy Year, with which plenary indulgence is granted to the faithful from all over the world on pilgrimage to Rome. The first Holy Year was proclaimed by Pope Boniface VIII in the year 1300. During the Sunday Mass, a long procession moves slowly towards the papal altar, below which is the tomb of St. Peter. Before the tomb, the faithful are in constant prayer. On special occasions, the Holy Father celebrates Mass at the papal altar. Having passed through the monumental entrance, remarkable double circular ramps take us to the upper floors where, in more than 1,400 rooms, there is one of the richest and most vast collections of art in the world. In the Cortile del Belvedere is the statue of Apollo, again a Roman copy of a Greek original by Leo Carres, dating from the 4th century BC. It is remarkable for the slim lines of the body and the elegant cloak. In fact, this statue perfectly personifies the ideal of virile beauty. The Laoconte group, an original work of the 1st century BC by the sculptors Agesander, Athenodorus, and Polydorus. In the lively sequence of the action, what strikes us is the anguished expression of the priest Laocoon, who, having aroused the ire of Athene, was attacked, together with his sons, by sea serpents. The powerful Belvedere torso signed by Apollonius, son of Nestor, and is dated 1st century BC. An interesting effect in perspective of the gatherers of the candelabras, of the tapestries, of the maps, and of the Vatican Library. At only 26 years of age, Raphael painted a great cycle of frescoes for Pope Julius II. In the first room, in order of painting, is the Disputation of the Sacrament, which represents the triumph of the Eucharist. An ample parabolic rhythm unites the three superimposed hemicycles, giving an immediate view of the action. Opposite the Disputation of the Sacrament is the School of Athens, a great fresco for the balance of the masses and for the amplitude of the space. It shows us a temple in the style of Bramante, where there is an ideal meeting of philosophers and scientists of all periods, overcoming the differences of time and place. In detail, Plato and Aristotle, Heraclitus in the body of Michelangelo, added by the master after the fresco had been finished, and a self-portrait of Raphael. Opposite is the Deliverance of St. Peter, a masterpiece of luminosity and one of the most evocative of the entire cycle for the extraordinary invention of the effects against the light, which were completely new and most effective. The Sistine Chapel was built in the 15th century on the orders of Pope Sixtus IV, hence the name. The interior was painted in three phases. During the first, between 1481 and 1483, the greatest Tuscan and Umbrian artists of the period did the frescoes of the stories of the Old and New Testaments on the walls. Now let us see the most significant parts. The Donation of the Keys, Perugino's masterpiece. Against a Renaissance background, Christ hands the keys to Peter. The perspective is exceptionally harmonious and is immersed in a vast and luminous Umbrian landscape. Another work by Botticelli describes episodes from the life of Moses. The fresco is full of figures, Moses being represented seven times, and is fascinating for its lyrical and bucolic intensity. The two female figures in the foreground are refined and elegant. The Calling of St. Peter and St. Andrew by Ghirlandaio, Michelangelo's master, is painted in a vast range of color. The superb talent of Ghirlandaio as a portrait painter can be seen from the faces of the crowd that watches the events without the slightest reaction. Moses giving the rod to Joshua by Luca Signorelli and others. The work, although notable for the modeling of the figures, seems cramped because of the overcrowding. The next phase, from 1508 to 1512, is the painting of the vault by the 33-year-old Michelangelo on the orders of Pope Julius II. The master, whose realistic portrait we see here, daringly superimposed on the vault an architectural structure in perspective in which there are large and small panels with the nine stories of Genesis flanked by nudes and gigantic, strongly modeled figures of prophets and sibyls. In four long years, in the deepest solitude, lying on his back with his eyes fixed on the ceiling, the master created a superhuman world, modeled rather than painted, in which tower colossal, heroic figures clothed in intense colors. The vault will remain an inspiration and insuperable model for the generations of the future. Let us examine some details. The creation of Adam, Scorning any descriptive detail, Michelangelo focuses the attention of the observer on the instant in which the divine spark of life is transmitted into the first man who wakes from a deep sleep. In this scene of miraculous beauty, the artist reaches the peak of his universality. The Flood, an apocalyptic composition in which wretched humanity strives to save itself from an immeasurable tragedy. The biblical episode is split up into many terse scenes, dramatic and terrifying. The prophet Daniel is represented with a most beautiful effect of perspective. The Delphic Sibyl, a stupendous figure in which Michelangelo reaches the highest ideals of beauty and rhythmic proportions. The enchanting face lit by the warm chestnut-colored eyes, whose geometric construction is in the form of a rhombus, takes on the splendor of a diamond. Recently, after a long and difficult restoration, the colors of the painting have regained their original splendor. The last phase, from 1534 to 1541, again concerns Michelangelo, for he then painted the Last Judgment. The artist is now on the threshold of old age. He was to die at the age of 89. In this immense composition, he represents the last act in the tragedy of mankind. A hurricane of wind sweeps everything before it. The cold, almost spectral figures are represented with crude realism. Low down on the left, the dead resume their flesh and ascend into heaven, while on the right, they are sent down to the depths of hell. Michelangelo represented the figure of Minos in the likeness of Cardinal Biagio da Cesena, who was always running down the work. Below the figure of Christ is that of Saint Bartholomew the Martyr, who, having been flayed alive, holds out his own skin, on which we see the face of Michelangelo. Above all this is the vigorous figure of Christ in judgment. We conclude these 50 years of the history of the papacy with the voice of Pope Wojtyla speaking during an Easter celebration.
Et benedictio Dei omnipotentis, Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti, descenda super vos et maneat semper.
The city of Ostia Antica was founded in the 4th century before Christ and was an important military and commercial port for Rome with a population of 50,000 inhabitants. It was enlarged and rebuilt by the Emperor Hadrian with a considerable number of new town planning solutions. This is the city's forum with the temple of the Capitoline Triad. The baths, some ruins of which we see here, heating plants, baths, and various rooms, decorated with many colored marbles. Here are the well-preserved public lavatories. They were for collective use and show remarkably advanced techniques in hygiene. The classic semicircular Roman theater was built by Agrippa. Behind the stage, we find the Piazzale delle Corporazioni, the square of the guilds, surrounded by a square portico with columns under which there were 70 offices of the trades of the ancient Roman world. It was the commercial center of the city. At the door of each office is marked the trade in mosaics. Merchant seamen, boatmen, cordwainers, tanners, Carthaginian, Ostian, and Roman millers of grain. And interesting apartment houses for families rising to several stories. An amazing view of little houses, all the same, like a modern housing estate, each surrounded by a little plot of land. Indeed, coming events cast their shadow before. The Villa d'Este at Tivoli was built during the 16th century by Pirro Ligorio for Cardinal Ippolito II at d'Este, a magnificent example of a Renaissance villa with not only an Italian garden, but also an extraordinary work of hydraulic engineering that is absolutely unique. In fact, in the gardens of the villa, there are 500 artistic fountains fed by the waters of the river Agnene. Let us visit the most picturesque corners. La Fontana della Rometta, Little Rome, inspired by ancient Rome. The Avenue of the Hundred Fountains. The jets of water alternate with the fleur-de-lis and the d'Este eagle. The goddess of Tivoli dominates the Fontana dell'Ovato, the egg-shaped fountain, rich in statues and fantastic fountains. The Dragon Fountain. The Owl Fountain, decorated with mosaics. And lastly, a view over the three fish ponds with the fountain of the hydraulic organ in the background. The towering jets of water, all produced by gravity. The kiosk above it at one time housed a famous water-operated organ. With this panoramic view of the Eternal City, the heart of Christendom, cradle of art and culture, we leave 30 centuries of history and civilization.